I had the honor of being the admitting physician for the first patient. And it was quite a great experience because our team had trained for these sort of activations, these sort of patients, for several years. And we were finally able to use all of our training to care for two wonderful patients.
We were really shocked when we saw those images. I think very few of us will forget of Dr. Kent Brantley walking under his own power into the hospital, albeit in one of those white space suits. He'd come from isolation from the airplane, transferred here into your hospital. Talk about the recovery. I mean, just 3 weeks in the hospital. I know you can't speak specifically about the treatment they received, but give us an idea of the day-to-day reality for them when they were in the hospital.
Of course. So the patients, once they were admitted to our unit, were able to be monitored by the monitoring devices that we use here in American hospitals, such as monitoring their heart rates, their blood pressure, their oxygenation levels, as well as being able to get laboratories every day on them to monitor their electrolyte levels, their kidney and liver function, as well as their cell count levels in their blood. And therefore, we were able to intervene on any abnormalities there very readily and on a day-to-day basis. And therefore, able to tailor the care of both patients to their individual's needs on that day, which is sometimes hard to do in resource-limited environments.
Yeah, well, and that's the point people are making about the scene here in America as opposed to where to West Africa. Now, look, these were two different patients, 33, and I think Nancy Reibold was in her 60s. Yet they both recovered. We know they both had ZMAP. Do you feel that that was the key? Was it early intervention? Do you think it was the aftercare that they were getting in Emory?
It's very hard to comment on the effect of any experimental medications because they, by nature, are experimental, and we don't have the data yet to ascertain what effect they have and how much it influenced the outcome we have in these two patients. Hopefully, in the future, there'll be additional studies done on this medication as well as other upcoming experimental medications, and we'll be able to really understand which medications should be used at what point of time in Ebola infection. As Dr. Ribner had said yesterday during the press conference, we really believe that the aggressive supportive care that we were able to deliver to the patients was effective in their good outcomes. I also think we had a wonderful team of physicians, nurses, laboratory personnel who were all able to intervene to help these patients. I think that was a big part.
I need to have real talk with you here for a second because I think what also amazed us was the fact that all of you were, of course, smiles to see Dr. Kent Brantley looking so hale and hearty. You all hugged him. We have been told how infectious this disease is and how it could be transferred from bodily fluid or what have you. This is a big statement. All of you, all of the physicians, all of the care team hugged him. There's no chance. There's no chance this virus lingers in him.
So he is not a risk to transmit this infection to anyone he's coming in contact with. And I don't think we planned the group hug, but it was a really rewarding moment for all of us. And it's one of the things we look forward to as physicians, being able to shake hands and hug our patients as they're recovered and heading home. All of us have families and friends at home. And so if we thought this either one of these patients were at all risk to our community, we would have kept them in the hospital.